wanted to harm children. This was done as a money-making venture. It was also done by very highly organized criminals.
Hey boy, take a look at me. Let me dirty up your mind. I'll strip away your heart veneer and see what I can find.
While I was researching the Ellen Guest House, another video which I will get to, but the story is just massive. Another case connected to the Ellen Guest House grabbed my attention. It's the story of a Londoner called Warwick Spinks. He was trafficking children from London to Amsterdam, not just for sex. This involves snuff films too.
This man has a remarkable story to tell. He claims to have infiltrated a secret world and collected information about the appalling activities of British criminals living in Amsterdam.
This was done by people who knew people who wanted to harm children. This was done as a money-making venture. It was also done by very highly organized criminals.
The allegations in this program may seem beyond belief that British men living in Amsterdam have been making money from sex crimes for which children have paid with their lives.
I can remember each face separately. I can remember them in detail.
What age were they? What were their appearances?
They were all aged between 9 and 10, 11 at the very oldest. They were all very thin, very young boys.
Tonight, for the first time, Edward describes how he stumbled into a terrible hidden world where young children are abused and then murdered, all before the unblinking eye of the video camera.
The police say they've never seen a genuine tape where a child is actually killed. Surely it's more likely that this was a clever fake.
No, it's not a clever fake. These tapes do exist. The problem is that it is so hard for people like you and I to believe that there are people out there that would do that to children, that it is easier for us to dismiss it as being a fable. In the Second World War, people didn't believe that there were concentration camps, and there were. It is easier to believe that I'm lying than to believe that these tapes are real.
No police force in the world has ever seen a genuine so-called snuff movie where a child is actually killed in front of the camera. But tapes have been seized where children are terribly abused. In this case, the victim was an 8-year-old boy called Bjorn. The Swedish police released extracts from one tape to Swedish television, who passed them to us. In Britain, what was the Obscene Publication Squad is now reorganised as the Paedophilia Unit. 15 officers work full-time trying to catch the paedophiles and identify their victims. Thousands of tapes are laboriously examined, since paedophiles will often hide obscene material on apparently innocent recordings.
Thankfully, most people have never seen what's referred to as child pornography. And I think if you ask them the question what child pornography is, they'll conjure up in their mind the image that they can deal with on a personal level. What we actually deal with here, which is unfortunately often referred to as kiddie porn, is the evidence of serious sexual crimes against children. And that evidence is contained in the films, whether it be on video or photograph.
The paedophilia unit at Scotland Yard has also seized a copy of the Bjorn tape. Their interest is in the English men who made the tape and the young boy they abuse.
And it shows a young boy, aged between 7 and 8 years, carried into a room. He's hooded. He's taken to a chair, or he's tied to the chair. And then, over a period of time, he is sexually abused in the most horrific way.
The police believe the man is from the south of England and is called John. The boy is European but speaks English. At one point, he warns John not to show his face.
The boy shouts, "Your face," which tends to show that he's either been told that there's obviously a monitor in front of him where he can see what's happening, and he's been told that if at any stage the abuser's face is on there, he is to say.
The paedophilia unit has asked us to show this picture from the Bjorn tape to help them identify the English man, John.
When some of them say that they love children, and when you see this type of film, there's no way they can say they love children.
Why not?
Because the terror that is in this child's face and the fear that is there to actually drug a child, to actually wake him up, hear him scream when he is buggered, there's no way that he can say that child is enjoying it.
This man says he has seen 5 tapes where children have not only been sexually abused, they've also been tortured and then killed in front of the camera.
So 5 different men,
yes,
killed children on these tapes?
Yes, 5 different.
And allowed themselves to be videotaped doing so?
Yes.
That really does strain the bounds of credibility, doesn't it?
But the people who wanted these tapes to be made were people who wanted to kill children. They wanted the memory of it. They wanted to see it in person. They wanted to do it. And they wanted something to remember it by.
The problem with this claim is that no one has yet found any physical evidence to prove that murders have been committed on videotape.
We've recovered a number of videotapes which feature the horrendous abuse of children, including torture. Thankfully, no law enforcement officer anywhere in the world has ever found what is known as a snuff video.
Does that mean they don't exist?
We don't know. Having said that, the characteristics of some of these offenders might suggest that they're capable of this, particularly the offender with sadistic tendencies.
In the late 1980s, when he was 22, Edward moved from Birmingham to Amsterdam to take advantage of its more liberal attitudes towards homosexuality. Edward insists he is not a paedophile, but burdened by the horrors he has witnessed, he's decided to speak out publicly for the first time about the hidden world of perversion and murder he discovered.
The other thing that many people might think, because this is so difficult to comprehend, is that you've simply fantasized this, that this is the product of your imagination.
It's a very warped imagination for somebody to dream something like this up.
But people sometimes have warped imaginations.
Not when you consider the people that I'm actually describing.
Edward met British paedophiles of every description in Amsterdam. The most alarming figure was Warwick Spinks, who's currently coming to the end of a 5-year jail sentence in England for the rape and abduction of a 14-year-old boy.
Warwick Spinks was a very, very plausible individual, a man who gave off an impression of being wealthy. He actually was able to speak many languages. Being travelling extensively, he was able to meet people, talk about his meetings with people. Some say he had a magnetic character. He was very loud, brash, is another description, but underneath he's very dangerous.
Edward is a former friend of Warwick Spinks. Edward says he's finally decided to tell his story because he cannot forget one apparently simple incident in the centre of Amsterdam when he met Spinks and a young boy.
he turned up one day with a boy gripped very tightly by the arm. The boy was only about seven or eight, typical Dutch-looking boy, blonde hair and blue eyes, and the boy looked absolutely terrified.
What did Warwick say to you?
He glanced down at the boy and said, I've got a delivery, I'm going to be another half an hour. I don't know what happened to the boy. I never saw the boy again, and decided not to ask Warwick what he actually meant by making a delivery.
He was very adept at identifying vulnerable children. He would visit railway stations, streets in London, and having identified a child, he would then convince the child that it was in his interests to know him. He would also eventually sexually abuse them. But on that basis, he would always have at the back of his mind, I suspect, that there was an opportunity to take the child to Amsterdam.
When Edward met Spinks, the friendly Londoner was working as a barman and pimp in a brothel called the Gay Place.
Upstairs was a gay brothel for prostitutes, male prostitutes. Warwick's job there was basically to pimp for the prostitutes upstairs and also, of course, to encourage other prostitutes to join.
In Holland, prostitution, gay or straight, is tolerated and open. Boys under the age of 16 are not allowed to work in brothels, but paedophiles who want to have sex with much younger children can find what they want in Amsterdam. Men like Warwick Spinks need a steady supply of vulnerable young boys. Men like Warwick Spinks are expert at targeting and exploiting vulnerable young people they meet on the street.
He would go to London or Munich or Berlin, so he was able to approach the boys and offer them something that they needed at the time, whether that was just a roof over their head, or security, or money, or drugs, or just two meals a day.
In November 1992, 17-year-old Kenny was homeless, penniless, and drifting into drugs. He was the perfect target for Warwick Spinks.
I didn't have much friends at the time, and he seemed okay, he seemed genuine. I didn't know that Warwick was gay until the following night, when we was in the pubs and the clubs, and until I saw Warwick, the way he worked, the way he was getting on with people.
Spinks persuaded 17-year-old Kenny to travel with him to a private gay club in Amsterdam.
He then got a book out showing young boys. He passed it to me. I felt terrified. I didn't know what the next question was going to be. When he showed me the book, he was enjoying it. It wasn't just about money. I mean, he got kicks from it. He loved it. It showed, I would say, about 15 to 20 photographs of young boys between 9 and 13. Completely naked, like showing their penis off, I mean, everything on their body. Some of them wasn't smiling. Some of them looked, I don't know, scared. Some of them looked drugged up, some of them looked happy as they wanted to do what they were doing. But most of the photographs, I saw that they did not want to do it. And that's what gave me the bad vibe.
Did it say anything with any of the photographs?
Yeah, there was a photograph, and it says a virgin, and it's the only thing that actually said, it was the only photograph that actually said it.
And what age would that boy be?
I think he'd be about 10, 11. He was only a child.
Kenny ended up owing Spinks hundreds of pounds. When he couldn't pay up, Spinks suggested an alternative method of clearing his debt.
He says the only way you can pay it off is to get young boys. And what he meant, and what I totally understood, is he Morrick wanted young male boys to go with him and make sexual films. I told him no. I told him that it's just out of the question. I'd pay him in instalments if he likes it or not. Warwick started to get violent, not fighting violent, but sexually violent, pushing me around. He was laughing. He enjoyed it.
Kenny says Spinks raped him that night. Spinks also told the teenager why he wanted younger boys.
I says, well, what do you get out of it? And he says he likes them to bleed. He likes them to cry. He likes to see pain. He gets orgasms over the pain. And, I mean, that's what he does. He just enjoys it. He says to me, he likes the boys to cry. He enjoys the boys to cry. He wants the boys to cry. And he goes out to make them cry. And I think that's his hit. That's his ambition. That's what he wants.
Kenny refused to help Spinks find younger boys and managed to break away from the sinister world into which he had stumbled. Others weren't so lucky. Edward says that he didn't realize Spinks was both a paedophile and a pimp until it was too late.
People would approach him, being the sort of character he was, and say that they wanted to have sex with boys who were younger than were allowed in the brothels, or to have rough sex or extremely dangerous sex with underage children.
The challenge for Spinks was to find a steady supply of underage boys to feed the appetites of his clients in Amsterdam. The Londoner had his favourite hunting grounds. One was Piccadilly Circus.
A lot of people know that if you want a male prostitute, this is where you'll come for one. They'll sit in the front windows of the fast foods or the coffee shops, hang around on the railings, and it's punters that want a young man will come here. Listen to me.
Sergeant Steve Edwards is constantly on the lookout for young homeless boys who often end up selling themselves as prostitutes. They're known on the street as rent boys.
I think it's been explained to you.
Well, I said to you earlier on, I now have more evidence that you are renting, all right?
Because
you've got...
Renting.
You're renting.
Look at this.
Yeah? You're
it's
renting.
It's a message. Nice to meet you. Give us a call.
Warwick Spinks would prey on children that were vulnerable in their own life, that needed things that they didn't have, things that they perceived can be offered by people like Warwick Spinks. And particularly bearing in mind he would travel to the areas where vulnerable children would tend to congregate, whether it be runaways from home, strangers to particularly London, he would know that they were there particularly because they were vulnerable.
Spinks' next victim, Gary, was just 14 years old. He and a friend had run away from a children's home in the north of England and were living on the street in London when they first met Warwick Spinks.
We're living rough for about a night, two nights or something like that. Shabby, it was cold, we had nothing to eat, we were sat on a wall. When Warwick approached us, we were only 14. We just thought he was a genuine guy, so we thought, right, we might be able to get a bed for a night, something to eat, some grub, we were starving, but no to eat and no money. So we went down with him.
The boys travelled with Spinks to his flat in Hastings.
Then he pulled out a knife and then told us to take our clothes off and perform sexual acts with each other. Right? Do stuff while he took pictures and then sexually abused us both.
Why was he taking the pictures?
Paedophiling, you know. He was sending it to Amsterdam and his different little places so he could make money.
Hooked on drugs and totally under Spink's control, the 14-year-old was taken on a terrifying journey to a strange city.
I didn't know what to do, so then he said we're going to Amsterdam to go and pick up some drugs. So I went across with him, and then he sort of sold me onto a brothel.
Gary says he was sold by Spinks at the Blue Boy, a notorious gay brothel in the heart of Amsterdam.
And what happened to you then? I got sexually abused by all the punters, or the landlord. They used to just give the boys drugs, give me drugs, so you zombied. Even if you didn't want drugs, they'd give you them anyway. Put them in your drinks, and you couldn't move, and then people could do what they wanted to you.
Spinks was first identified as a dangerous child abuser in 1992. He divided his time between England and Amsterdam, introducing sex tourists to young boys. He told one undercover cop he could arrange sex with boys in Germany, Prague, and Poland for as little as 10p. He was also secretly taped offering to supply a snuff video in which a boy at 10 was killed for kicks. In 1995, he was jailed for 7 years at Lewis Crown Court, East Sussex, for several offences against underage boys. His sentence was cut to 5 years on appeal, but when let out on licence in 1997, he fled the UK, violating his probation conditions. Spinks was tracked down in Prague in 2000, running sex tours for paedophiles. But he evaded justice and was finally extradited last November, a coup hailed by the Child Exploitation and Online Protection Centre. It had branded him one of the most notorious and violent offenders we have ever dealt with. The Ministry of Justice refused to comment last night, but a source admitted Spink's release was embarrassing. In Prague, where the age of consent is 15 and prostitution is legal for over 18s, vile Spink's aims to take advantage. He told our undercover man, "I fully intend getting old disgracefully." In 1992, he is quizzed by London cops on links to Euro-pedo rings. He fixes sex with boys for tourists in Holland and offers to sell them sick torture films. In 1993, a lad of 14 says he was raped at knife point and sold to a Dutch brothel after Spinks lured him to his home in Hastings, Sussex. In 1995, Spinks is jailed at Lewes, Sussex, for offences including drugging and kidnapping the 14-year-old boy and committed sex acts on him. In 1997, described as one of Britain's most dangerous paedophiles, Spinks is released from prison on licence and immediately flees. In 1998, the fiend sets up an agency in Prague after flitting between bolt holes. A warrant is issued when he is spotted in the Canaries in 2001. In 2012, Spinks is finally flown back to the UK and arrested at Heathrow. But he is freed in 2013 and returns to his old haunts in Prague.
In 1995, Warwick Spinks was jailed for 5 years for selling a 14-year-old British boy in a Dutch brothel.
There's no doubt in my mind that Warwick Spinks was offering children to men for sex. When we searched his house, we found a list that he called the Clanton list, the client list, with the young'un, which is another expression for boys, with various details of them and their bodies shown on it, and also the various interests of the clients. So I've no doubt that this was the business operated by him.
Edward claims that he only discovered the truth about the child prostitution ring run by Warwick Spinks after he'd broken away from the scene in Amsterdam.
Warwick came up with the idea of having boats just outside of Amsterdam where these clients could go. There would be a young boy on the boat and there would be the client on the boat, and then they would be able to do whatever they wanted to the boy.
This man, Edward, insists he has seen 5 videotapes where children have been sexually abused, tortured, and then killed in front of a camera.
The man was on board with the boy. He was allowed to do anything that he wanted to do to the boy. Things got out of hand and the boy ended up dying, which was recorded on a video camera.
How did the boy die?
Yeah, he suffocated on the genitals of the man.
And what happened after the boy had apparently suffocated on the tape? What did you see on the tape?
That there was panic, that there was a lot of running in and out. The camera got hit from the side and blanked out. But the whole thing was, it was inevitable that this was actually going to happen. There was sound on the camera. You could hear the waves lapping against the side of the boat. You could hear noises of waterfowl in the background. You could hear the boy gagging. You could hear the man grunting. When the boy actually died, you could hear the panic in the man's voice.
Edward has no criminal record. He has not been paid for telling his story. And since talking to us, he has been interviewed by both the British and Dutch police and has offered to work with them to prove that what he says is true. The Dutch police have now launched a formal inquiry into Edward's allegations. The reason Edward has to be taken seriously is that he's pointing a finger at a man with a track record of appalling sexual violence towards young boys. Warwick Spinks was placed under surveillance by Scotland Yard precisely because of information received that he was selling tapes of children being tortured and killed. In a remarkable and revealing conversation when he did not know he was being secretly recorded by undercover police officers in Holland, Spinks boasted of his knowledge of snuff movies. An actor reads from the official police transcript.
I know somebody who was in a snuff movie, and somebody got snuffed in front of him. He was from Birmingham, middle 20s. I know the person who made the film. I felt sorry for this boy. He was a German boy, about 13, 15. He thought he was going to make 200 guilders, and ended up being dead. I know I'm a fat old queen, but I get away with murder.
Rumours of the existence of what are known as snuff movies have been around for a very long time. Law enforcement officers have never ever found one of these. However, it's fair to say that in my experience we've witnessed video films of horrendous abuse of children arriving at a point where they are tortured.
From prison, Spinks denies committing any crime.
I had 3 brothels in Amsterdam, but that is not in itself, does not make me a murderer. It does not make me an associate of murderers. It does not mean I'm in a pedophile ring, because I've never had anything to do with anything like that.
I think Warwick Spinks is completely disgusting. He's put a lot of people through a lot of pain. He doesn't care about the consequences. He just don't think about that. He just wants the boys, he just wants the money. And if he doesn't get it, he'll go out and get it, and he will go out and get it.
Spinks is in prison because he sold one 14-year-old British boy into sexual slavery in this Amsterdam brothel. His victim, Gary, will never forget him.
If I ever seen him again, it wouldn't be like I'm a little boy. It'd be completely different altogether. He's fucked up my life completely. He's damaged me inside, which, do you know what I mean? You can beat someone up, but you can't damage him emotionally like he has done to me and a lot of other people who he's done it to.
Edward insists that not only was Spinks involved in the systematic abuse of children, he was also involved in their murder. At our request, Edward has helped the Dutch police find the house in a suburb of Amsterdam where he says he was shown videos of young boys being killed. And Edward has described to the police the lake where the men he met at the house told him they had disposed of the bodies.
But if Spinks and the gang are arranging for the murder of children on this kind of scale, almost a production line, surely it would have come to the attention of the authorities.
The boys that they chose would have been homeless and they would have been very vulnerable children. There was a boy with sallow skin and brown hair, brown eyes, which is unusual for Amsterdam. I've no idea where they got him from. There were two blonde-haired boys and a strawberry blonde boy and a boy with a very distinctive haircut. It was shaved over both ears with a loop and a parting down the middle.
Did the boys speak on the tips?
They cried and screamed. They did cry out, but I don't know what language they were crying out in.
Acting on our information, the Dutch police have now taken lengthy detailed statements from Edward. The Dutch Justice Ministry has launched a full inquiry into his allegations. They already know that Warwick Spinks has a history of gross sexual violence towards young people. And they know that he has been repeatedly identified to the British police as a possible supplier of snuff movies. British Customs have confirmed to us that Edward first offered his incredible story to them in 1991. At that time, he was not believed. Given the sort of abuse the police see on tapes that they have seized, they do agree that children may have been killed for the camera.
I mean, short of actually, I would say, fatally injuring this child and him dying, I don't think there's anything else they can do to him. It's so horrific that and the boys. He obviously can point the finger at the abuser if he is eventually found. So I wouldn't like to say what has happened to this boy. I find it quite frightening that that they've done this much to him. And I don't think that the next step could be that they've killed him.
Edward says that he's speaking out now because he can no longer live with his failure to act when he first saw Warwick Spinks leading off a young boy in the centre of Amsterdam.
In the films that I saw five children killed. And it was organised and orchestrated by Warwick and his associates. I had no control over the boys that were killed on the tapes. There was nothing I could do other than try and bring it to the attention of the authorities when I was back in England. But I did see Warwick with that boy outside the Spoustraat, the gay palace, and I didn't do anything about it at the time. And I don't know how he worked out.
What do you think happened to that boy?
I don't know. I think that Warwick is a very evil man, and anything could have happened to that boy. With what I know now about Warwick, I should have done more. But when you see a boy in the flesh, as opposed to seeing him on tape, it's a different thing entirely.
Do you blame yourself?
Yes.
What do you hope will happen as a result of speaking out now?
I hope that they go to jail for the rest of their lives. And I hope that the boys who they killed, their families will know. And I hope maybe one day I'll find out what happened to the boy that Warwick was with that day.
Former Radio 1 DJ Chris Denning, 59, a friend of Jonathan King's, another paedophile, since the 70s, was jailed for 4.5 years by a court in Prague last year on 10 charges of sexually abusing young boys. King's name was mentioned by one of his victims. Denning was in the original Radio 1 lineup in 1967 and worked with King as a record producer. Denning of Bracknell, Berks, has convictions in Britain dating back 30 years for sexual assault, gross indecency and child porn. During visits to Prague seeking victims, Denning befriended Britain's most wanted paedophile, Warwick Spinks. Spinks, 35, was jailed for 7 years in 1995 after drugging a 14-year-old boy and selling him to a gay brothel in Amsterdam. He served 30 months, then fled the country while on parole. The raid was part of a probe into paedophile package tours to Prague organised by Vile Spinks, in which boys as young as 10 were abused.
Now, one of the reasons it's taken me so long to do the Elam Guesthouse video is because it's full of disinformation. A lot of it is being used for political gains. But luckily, I've got speaking to somebody that was very much part of it, and they have shown me the right direction to go. But you get an awful lot of stuff exactly like this.
I heard the car, the engine. And as I turned round,
Carol Beach, 51, who was known as Nick throughout the Operation Midland investigation, told the court how Mr. Beach had gone to Scotland Yard in 2014, claiming to have been sadistically sexually abused by a group of powerful public figures, including Sir Edward Heath, the former Prime Minister, Lord Britton, the former Home Secretary, Field Marshal Lord Bramnell, and Harvey Proctor, the former Tory MP. He even claimed the group had murdered 3 boys in front of him.
While all the names that Carol mentions are relevant to the Elam Guesthouse, he also mentions that one of the MPs was with Warwick when he killed one of the kids and made the snuff film. He also claimed that Warwick was a regular at the Elam Guesthouse. Now, Warwick would only be 16 when it was shut down, so I don't know where he got that from. But the police looked into Carol too, and they found child porn on his computer. And when he was questioned about it, he blamed his son.
Mr. Benich explained that as part of the police investigations, officers had seized a number of electronic devices belonging to Mr. Beach and found indecent images of young boys, secretly taken photographs of schoolboys, a covert recording of a boy using the lavatory at his house. The barrister said these child sex offences were committed while he was speaking to investigating police officers. At the same time, he perpetrated these lies about Harvey Proctor and so many others. He was also viewing indecent images of the gravest kind and spying on small boys. The jury was told that when confronted with the evidence, Mr. Beach had initially pleaded not guilty, even suggesting that his son might have been responsible for the material. But just as the trial had been about to get going in January, he changed his plea and admitted the offences.
Claimed a VIP paedophile ring operated at the heart of the British establishment. He claimed a prominent politician had murdered 2 young children. He claimed he was also abused. None of it was true.
I just remember being called and having to get my things.
In 2012, Carl Beach went to the Metropolitan Police with a string of detailed and breathtaking allegations. He alleged many crimes took place here in Westminster in the 1970s and 80s. According to him, public figures, including the former Prime Minister Edward Heath and former Home Secretary Leon Britton, were leading paedophiles. It took a jury today under 5 hours to find this is all untrue and that he was a fantasist.
Carl Beach is a manipulative liar. He has made allegations against individuals of the most shocking nature, which are entirely untrue. He's persisted in those allegations throughout lengthy police investigations, and indeed he continues to persist in those allegations to this day.
Known to the police as Nick, they said his claims, which included details that former army generals headed a paedophile ring, were believable. The Met began Operation Midland as a result of those claims in 2012. In 2016, the operation ended without a single arrest at a cost of almost £2 million. But his most damaging false allegation was that he witnessed the former Conservative MP Harvey Proctor murder two young boys. He always strenuously denied the claims against him. Today, Harvey Proctor labelled this entire episode as a disgraceful chapter in the history of British policing.
If only the Metropolitan Police Service had conducted itself in a similar efficient and competent manner to Northumbria Police, the damage done by Mr. Carl Beach's criminality would have been drastically reduced.
Today, the Met Police reaffirm they've apologised to victims, as well as stating the investigation of abuse claims is extremely complex.
Whilst the Met is clear that our organisation did not get everything right, the IPC stated in March 2017 that it had found no evidence to indicate bad faith, malice or dishonesty on the part of our officers as they investigated the allegations made by Beach.
We can now report that Carl Beach is a paedophile. He admitted possessing indecent images of hundreds of children earlier this year. The motivation behind his complex lies remains unclear, but his level of deceit, which impacted so many lives, now raises more questions for the Met Police about the way in which they approach investigations. Carl Beach will be sentenced on Friday. Warren Nettleford, 5 News.
So like I said before, the Ellen Guest House is still coming. It's just taking a bit more longer to iron out all the facts. So, as always, please like, share, and subscribe. And if you like my work, please consider joining my Patreon. See you on the next one, guys.